So anyway, welcome. Today, again, is something we're very proud of to put on here at the Yakima Valley Museum. This core lecture series is just an excellent talks, and what they're going to address, of course, is the best evidence, including the Patterson-Gimlin film, of course, but culminate with Bill Munz's talk. But Jeff Meldrum, thank you for joining us, Jeff, and looking forward to your presentation, and John Bindernagel. We hold you all in high regard, and thank you for your participation. So to begin, before we have Lenny play a song, Andy Granito, who, by the way, let's hear it for Andy Granito, our host.
Yeah. Hi, I want to thank you all so much for being here. I'll be brief, but on behalf of the museum staff, which is about four or five people, Mike there at the sound is our collections curator. That's my wife, Peg, who's exhibit technician. I'm the exhibit designer. Our director, John Ball, thanks you all for being here. But I wanted to briefly say that we kind of went out on a limb a little bit getting this exhibit. It's not the normal thing for a museum like ours. And so I guess first off, I want to thank Christopher Murphy, who put together that collection of objects. When I saw those, I said, we have to make this into an exhibit, because while I was familiar with the subject, I knew nothing about it, and this would put everything out there so people could see the history. So I wanted to thank Chris. Then I also wanted to thank John Kirk and Bob Gimlin, who were here at the opening with Chris, who basically thanked us for the exhibit, and we immediately said anything that could get more people here to see it. That started the ball rolling. I think it was John Kirk who recommended Tom Yameron, who I think gets the most thanks of anyone.
Yeah.
I know he's talked about a couple hundred hours. I think it's probably a couple thousand hours on his part. Been basically corresponding with him all summer to get this to happen. We kind of put together the place here to work, but the whole coordination, getting you all here, all the communication was all Tom. And I want you all to thank him. And the only other thing I'll say in that regard is, or towards thanking you all for being here. I know a lot of you last night when we were serving wine and beer were saying thank you. What could we do to help? We said it's all part of the program. I encourage you to support our museum and museums like ours. You might not know it. We get no support from our city, no support from our county, no tax support whatsoever. It's all the generosity of people who appreciate what we do. So, if any of you want to join the museum, you can join up front. You'll keep in touch with what's going on. If you just want to thank us for hosting, there are donation boxes around, and we appreciate anything you can do to help us. We're a tiny staff, but we work hard, and we're so glad you're here. Thanks again to all of you, and to Tom, and to Bob, and everyone who's speaking. And I won't waste any more of your time. Thanks so much.
I typically like to run a tight schedule, but I think today we're going to go over a little bit here. But Lenny Green, many of you know who this is, and it's a real honor and pleasure to have Lenny and Paul Graves and, sharing music. I always like to add a little song before the excellent talk, so enjoy the music of Lenny Green.
Yeah.
Every time I've seen the PG film, I've got this little fleeting thought that kind of runs through my mind, like, whatever happened to her? Wonder whatever became of Patty. I know probably a lot of you have thought the same thing one time or another, and of course, there's no way of knowing. But anyway, it kind of led to this tribute song that I'd like to do for you, and hope you like it. Just a moment. Thank you.
came down from the mountain to where the crystal waters flow. No reason to consider company might show. What destiny would find you where you walked across the sand to leave a world divided? Did Roger film a Bigfoot or man? Where are you now, Patty? And are you with us still? World you split into has not forgotten you. Doubt we ever will. Do you still go down to Bluff Creek, where the cowboys came that day? Where are you now, Patty? Where are you today? How many years does a Bigfoot have before they say goodbye? How many years would you have now, Patty, if you still walk beneath our skies? Believe the fame Roger brought to you that day. And Patty may not be a Bigfoot name, it's yours now to stay. And we can't help but wonder now and then, though it's been so long ago, you're still with a living, or lie somewhere that only Bigfoots know. Where are you now, Patty? And are you with us still? The world you split into has not forgotten you. Doubt we ever will. Do you still go down to Bluff Creek, where the cowboys came that day? Where are you now, Patty? Where are you today? Do you still go down to Bluff Creek, or do you only wish you could? Where are you now, hey? Or are you gone for good? Thank you.
Bindernagel, it's been, as you know, in the program, has been researching this subject close to 50 years or more. And his expertise and explanation of things is is something that is unparalleled. And so to have him here today is a great honor. And what he does in terms of attempting to get science to address this issue or to not treat it as a taboo subject is going to be what we will recall as a groundbreaking effort on your part, John. So without further ado, please welcome John Bindernagel.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Lenny. And thanks to all those who invited me to participate here today in honoring especially Bob Gimlin and the work that's been done by him and Roger, of course. My approach, the Patterson-Gimlin film is so significant that I use it as kind of a reference point. Work that was done before, which is largely unknown, actually, and work that's been done since. So start with just that frame from the Patterson-Gimlin film. Just get this little technical hitch dealt with at the outset. We'd like to point at the screen. Or at the left, huh? Well, you're going to operate, okay? Okay. So anyway, there's two very positive comments here from the book about the Patterson-Gimlin film. The centerpiece of Bigfoot lore is the Patterson-Gimlin film of 1967. The film stands as the centerpiece of Bigfoot evidence. It all sounds very affirming, except that it appears in a book called Bigfoot Exposed, An Anthropologist Examines America's Enduring Legend. And this, in fact, was this issue of raising something up just before trying to knock it down. And I guess the point is that the author makes one very good point, that the Patterson-Gimlin film has been the centerpiece of Bigfoot, I wouldn't call it lore, Bigfoot knowledge, I would say. And as such, there's been this attitude that if we can debunk that film, we've debunked Bigfoot. And I just want to talk a little bit about some of the evidence that came before and came after, and in a way to kind of take some of the pressure off the Patterson-Gimlin film, important as it is. So what I've done, I've started here working up the Patterson-Gimlin film. Next slide. And then staking from the film and moving on to where, and we have moved on. We have used it as a reference point, a place of encouragement, an item of encouragement, and moved on. Thank you. Okay, so let's talk first about myth and legend of early Americans, First Nations people, which of course go way, way back. Okay. Now, one of the things we have in British Columbia and Alaska especially, is totem poles. And some of the crests on totem poles are quite identifiable as existing animals, such as this frog. This is a little more difficult. This is a beaver, and there's a tendency in Aboriginal carving to kind of, and myth, to exaggerate certain characteristics of an animal. Like with the beaver, it's the prominent incisors, it's the flat tail with a checkering pattern, and in this case, a piece of wood held in the paws of a beaver. And then we come to Zunaqua, the wild woman of the woods. And I want to say, for some reason, it is not considered a mammal or an animal alongside frogs and beavers. But of course, we know that there's many reasons for that. But as Aboriginal elders will tell us, yes, Zunaqua, the wild woman of the wood, the female Sasquatch, is indeed an existing mammal. Then we come to maps such as this, which are more of a portrait map, very, very detailed, very with anatomical features spelled out. And this appears to be the mask of the ape-like Sasquatch, you know, the very wide mouth with the thin lips, the rather outward-facing nostrils, deep-set eyes, brow ridges, receding forehead, and chinlets. And this has been remarked upon by some anthropologists, although that's been kind of put aside. So let's move on to published historical accounts. Now, these interest me, because some of the really early ones, this is a report from Woodland, California, And it's, okay, the title was, What Is It? An Unheard of Monstrosity Seen in the Woods Above Rumsey, Rumsey being a community in the Kamei Valley. Also referred to later in the article as a strange creature and an unnamed animal. And the thing is, back in those days, we hadn't yet brought the Sasquatch into the area of primates. It was still a monster. And I want to mention here, and Tom mentioned a couple of times, Scott McLean, who unfortunately is no longer with us, who did some very, very good work at unearthing some of these very early accounts, which told us a great deal. So anyway, we moved on from this monstrosity, and here's quite a bit later, 1930, a report of an ape. This is, and there's a couple things here. First of all, it's seen near Sandusky, Ohio, and that's problematic. It was problematic for a lot of people who don't accept the Sasquatch east of the Rockies. But it's not to raise the argument of whether the Sasquatch is an ape or more human-like, but at least it brings us into the category of primates. And another historical account, also found by Scott McLean, spook, viper, devil, monkey, ape, or gorilla. So see, again, there's this kind of bringing in here, okay? And now this is an account I keep going back to because it just seems so important. 1904, the Lane County Leader, Southwest Oregon. And the editor had interviewed some miners on the Sixes River. And I pulled up three things from the interview. They, the miners, say he has something after the fashion of a gorilla and unlike anything else, either in appearance or action. Okay, so here we are. They've got a pretty sense, good sense of what it looks like. And then an element of behavior. He can throw rocks with wonderful force and accuracy. And then a little more detailed anatomy. He is about 7 feet high, has broad hands and feet, and his body is covered by a prolific growth of hair. And what I want to focus on is the comment of broad hands and feet, especially broad feet. Because, come 1995, with this particular cast, the particular track was cast in Westmoreland County, this is courtesy Eric Altman, in which the width of the track behind the toes is fully 50% of the length. A very broad track indeed. And another track from Jeff Meldrum's collection, a copy of which I have here, which I'm going to refer to again later, a copy which he gave me, cast in Southeast Washington, although I don't have scale here, it's only about between 7 and 8 inches long, and also very, very broad. So, we have that comment.
Sorry.
That's right. There. From Oliver Sacks, who was a neurologist and wrote some very, very, very good stuff. Anyway, one of his comments that struck me, we may look at the idea of history of ideas, backward or forward. In looking backward, we can trace the earlier stages, the intimations, the anticipations of what we know now. So I use that here to say, okay, back in 1904, we could have known that when we started finding Sasquatch tracks, they would be broad, and it was described for us then. But those reports have languished. Or we can say, gee, Sasquatch tracks, a lot of them seem to be very broad. Could we have known this before? Yes, we could have, you know. And so when he talks about them being the intimations of what we know now, it's what some of us know now. Okay, yes, carrying on. Okay, track cast and recent accounts and eyewitness description. Let's move on to that. An eyewitness drawing I often use because it just captures the whole essence of the Sasquatch is from the 1970s in Oregon, drawn by a school teacher who'd seen a Sasquatch. And it kind of reveals our dilemma that yes, indeed, it does look like a giant human, except, you know, it has this covering of dark hair, these long arms, which happens to be an ape-like characteristic, and that short, thick neck. So I think he captures that quite well. And we have repetitions of this. This one from Mineral Lake, Washington, broad shoulder, probably a male. It was broad shoulders, that short, thick neck again.
Darren Richardson's.
And some described as females, sometimes on the basis of breasts, such as this one. And then, of course, the Patterson-Gimlin film. I'm sure that Bill Munns will address this, because both Jeff Meldrum and Bill Munns have been studying the film in great detail, and we'll share some of the results with us later. And sometimes they're described as females on the basis of the Sasquatch carrying an infant. And it's kind of interesting. Some of you may know, I just phoned this out before I left, there's a film being shown on the internet, a purported clip of a Sasquatch in which there is an adult carrying an infant in a position very similar to this, which is kind of ironical too, because this goes back to the 1970s from southern Alberta. And here is a very recent video from last year showing this. And that video, of course, is suffering the same problems as the Patterson-Gimlin film, whereas the Patterson-Gimlin film is accused of being fuzzy, simply because it's greatly enlarged. This one is too sharp. So they're complaining about, someone is criticizing possibly computer graphics. So anyway, that's an aside. Now, then there are some Sasquatches which are quite problematical because they appear to be young adults or sub-adults. Very, very human shape, very more human proportions. And this one confused a couple of hunters for some time because they thought, they were looking at a human with torn rain gear hanging down, and finally decided that evening in the cabin as the young person made that drawing that no, that was not a human. The human who knew they were there and they thought it was, wasn't nowhere around. It went on. And then another one from Ohio, courtesy of Don Keating. Again, those kind of human-like proportions of what we think is a sub-adult, a young adult Sasquatch. Then we have this problem, and this is a problem for people like me. If you can see, this is Field Guide to the Mammals. Before Googling things, we used to come home from a field trip, and if we'd seen a mammal or a bird we couldn't see, we either had the field guide with us, or we looked at home, and if we looked up a Sasquatch, and we thought we'd seen a Sasquatch, the closest thing we'd find here is a bear. In both my books, I have that illustration on the right, in what I call the missing illustration, the missing option. Because if we'd seen a Sasquatch, we'd be able to, yes, it had broad shoulders, very human-like shoulders, not the tapered shoulders of a bear. And from the side, it had a flat face, not the prominent snout of the bear. And so it helps me understand the resistance, the problems people have when they've seen a Sasquatch, because these books are a fairly new book. They should be complete by now. And our mammal lists for Washington State, British Columbia, Oregon, should be for continental North America, should be complete, at least for something weighing 700 pounds and 8 feet tall. So there's a real psychological dilemma here. Now, track cat. Let's just move to the next one. Yeah, there's this wonderful collection of track cats elsewhere in the museum here, and they're good because I often wondered. I was talking to Bob earlier. When he and Roger went out and got that film, was there any background of Sasquatch knowledge in the area? Yes, by that time, quite a number of Sasquatch tracks had been observed and cast. And there's one, and this is kind of interesting, because it goes back to October 1941, when Deputy Sheriff Joe Dunn from Bellingham, Washington, came up to BC and cast a Sasquatch track. Now that cast has been lost, but this tracing survives, courtesy John Green, who's been mentioned as archiving and writing and basically initiating a lot of Sasquatch research. And I find it ironical because Chris Murphy was talking about, certainly British Columbia does have a lot of reports that has good Sasquatch habitat, but we have been so conservative, and I speak mainly for my colleagues here. Here it was, a deputy sheriff from Bellingham, Washington, coming to British Columbia to, document BC evidence, and that seems to be the way. Here we are in Yakima having this great conference, and not so often in British Columbia, but that's kind of a... That's kind of another thing with me. People talk about scientists involved with this and how difficult it's been. And I guess the tragedy, I keep trying to bring it to my scientific colleagues in British Columbia, biology professionals. I think British Columbia one day will prove to have some of the best habitat, those clam beaches on the west coast. And we of all people should be addressing this, and we've been very slow to do so. So, okay, now we bring this up to the Patterson-Gimlin film, 1967, and right here. And okay, now addition of track cast and track photographs. Okay, let's move on. Okay, now these are here partly because the one on the left was actually cast by my wife Joan and I back in 1987. And that was a really kind of a neat thing to happen to me at that particular time. I had set Sasquatch research aside because I was still trying to establish myself as a bona fide, employable wildlife biologist in British Columbia. Talking about Sasquatch research was not a good idea, so I was temporarily retired from the subject. And then we did this school hike with a group of school. It was actually a group of girls with a male chaperone, and my wife was kind of willing to kind of just balance the whole situation. And there, these tracks were found. So we couldn't cast them on the way. We didn't have some casting materials with us. We were 3 days getting back there, and so I have that cast downstairs, and there's a bit of a boot print. The hiker did step in that one before we got a cast. But what's interesting is that more tracks were cast about 55 miles away 5 years later, elsewhere on Vancouver Island. And as has been remarked by both Jeff Meldman and Cliff Berrickman, this appears to be probably the same individual. The very interesting, I have both this cast and this cast. Very bulbous big toe, very similar morphology. Okay? The thing about cats, I mean, as a wildlife biologist, this is the best evidence. I mean, the film is great evidence, but for me, and this one should speak to biologists, when there's a track in the ground, and someone pours plaster into it, we come out, and here we have this representation of the foot that made the track. So why hasn't this great evidence, illustrated here in the museum and elsewhere, helped us move this along? Well, this idea of hoaxing has been introduced. 1982, we had Grant Mullins showing these carved wooden feet. And in 2002, Dale Wallace came forward after the death of his uncle saying, here's the explanation for all your Sasquatch tracks, folks. We got them right here, these fabricated wooden feet. Okay? And that explanation was very widely accepted. You know, newspaper headlines are going to have a bunch of these. Originator, and we're saying, gee, why are my scientific colleagues so convinced by this explanation? Can't they see that Matt Mullins hasn't even rounded off the square heel of his fabricated foot there? Next line. Mm-hmm. And can't they see that these tracks are, why, they have square toes? You know, the real cats don't have square toes, you know? And so, and what it basically shows is that our scientific colleagues have so badly wanted an explanation that they could live with, that they've embraced this explanation rather uncritically. Anyway, okay, there's a comment I wanted to raise here, historian Carl Becker. One of the first duties of man is not to be duped, to be aware of his world. And the question is, who is being duped? You know, I mean, most people think that things like the poor John, nice guy, but he's gone totally into the Sasquatch. He thinks he's a real mammal. And so they, a lot of my friends, well, colleagues, they think I've been duped. You know, it's okay when we talk about moose and mountain goats and grizzly bears, but if I want to talk about my Sasquatch report, you know, people have to be someplace else. And I'm saying, you know, Pat, like, for example, I'm saying, wait, we're trying to help you out. We think we know you've been duped. Sooner or later, you're going to have to address this evidence, even accept it. Anyway, so it's kind of an interesting perspective. Thanks. Okay, so now back to this cast. I'm so glad that, you know, Jeff gave me this copy years ago because I've had it to look at and study. So that was 1992 when it was cast. Now, next slide. Now, I started working with, collaborating with an investigator named Randy Brisson on the BC mainland. And going through, he'd been very good about sharing his files with me. And he said, I found some baby tracks one time. And here's these two small tracks. Next slide. And to his credit, he did get his boot down there, 11 and 3/4 inch boot, which makes those tracks down around 3 inches, almost half the length of these, but almost the identical shape. And it was quite an interesting situation. I mean, the whole experience involved. There's also adult tracks along with the young tracks. A stone was thrown, there was a strong smell. They must have arrived there. He and his son must have arrived there quite soon after the tracks were made, which is why he found them so fresh. But I think this is great. We're now sort of getting corroboration of some of this evidence, which is, this one in particular, seems to have stood alone for a long time, as far as I know. Another aspect of a Sasquatch tracks is what trackers call the trail or the trackway. And for some time now, we've known that Sasquatch trails tend to have this this configuration where the tracks are in line, and people have described as suggested. It's as if the animal was walking on a tightrope. And this is at variance with grizzly bear tracks, which show straddle or trail width, considerable straddle or trail width. Or humans, and where we, as we walk, show a little bit of trail width, and we also tend to scuff or slide our foot into a track and then drag our foot out, which again is similar to the Sasquatch. So here we have another contribution from Don Keating in Ohio, line of Sasquatch track. You get a sense of scale from the partial person there. The stride length is quite long, and they're lined up. Now, back to Randy Burson there, working in British Columbia, on the mainland, finding tracks in an area, in this case on a paved road with a slight covering of snow. You get a little bit of sense of scale from the shadow of the person. Very long stride, but very much in line. So two features there, which were quite interesting. And then there's Randy. He's not a tall person, only 5'7", but showing, you know, that this is a pretty big stretch for him. He said, you know, I myself couldn't recover from, you know, here's the tracks he's trying to illustrate there, and he basically fell over after that. But anyway, and again, not shown so well, but a long line of tracks along the road. And so it's encouraging that investigators are documenting, when they do document stuff like this, and it's not always perfect, there may not be scale, but anyway, yes. So, and I think there's one more of those lines of tracks in the sand, which was kind of interesting. Very, very clear. And I think the next slide shows an individual track. So, very nice. Now, we're working, you know, in the future, hopefully there'll be a tape measure, or even some can just drop a coin or something beside it, because scale is so important. And of course, when the tracks are this clear, it sure would be nice to have a cast of them for future reference, which can show so much more than just the image. But you know, I always try to be careful here, because sure, one can find fault with the way Sasquatch research is being carried out, but it's not being carried out by experienced, well-educated scientists, you know, who've had the benefit of a great public education at a university. No, it's people giving up their own time, especially on weekend, times when they're very tired, and they're doing their very best, because they're filling this vacuum, which has been left by scientists. So there's no way that amateur investigators can be criticized, because they're doing this great job. It's coming along very well. And one more, and this is an investigator in Ontario. Well, his name is Mike Patterson, and sometimes I don't, it's a case where he's got very good evidence, very good, I'll call it physical evidence. Jeff Moore correctly refers to this as trace evidence, because it's the trace or sign left by the animal. And I'm concerned that people, if we say trace, we mean minor. No, it's not minor at all. But anyway, kind of a broad track, very clear in the snow. And he's a professional photographer, has gotten very good about adding scale to his photographs. He tends to go maybe a little bit overboard in his interpretations into an area where most of us wouldn't go. But, you know, with scientists really not having provided much by way of explanation, that's going to happen. Okay, now we go into this area. Here's where things get kind of interesting for me. Just it's kind of where I am right now. All this apparent Sasquatch sign, modified trees, twisted and woven saplings, things we refer to as structures and shelters. They've been photographed and documented for some time, but maybe been ignored by some of us. Okay. And now, what I want to start with is the mammal sign. And any young person here who can tell me what mammal? No, I see no. The old people all know. Well, anyway. Yeah, it's beaver. And it's pretty distinctive, isn't it? I think we all know, yeah, we know the age where it's been cut off, and these here where it's working. And one more slide of again, beaver lodge in the middle of a pond, very distinctive. We don't need to see a beaver. We don't need to see beaver tracks. We know there's beavers in this area. Now, wouldn't it be nice if we could do that for Sasquatch? Well, some people say we can. Look at that. There must be Sasquatch here. Let's go ahead. This is the sort of thing, and these are slides. Some of these have been contributed by Winona Alexis from Alberta. And it's where someone has said, this is beyond natural. Something has, you know, accumulated and pulled together this, and I'll call it a structure, and some people call it a wheel, okay? Another one by Winona. And this is where it's interesting for me, where I perceive by my colleagues as somewhat radical, because I accept the Sasquatch's existence. I work with investigators, and I become the skeptic, saying, whoa, wait a minute, that looks natural to me. Oh, then there's a discussion. And you start working away, how could this have happened? And Winona agreed, I'm not sure, you know, if this is natural or not. Then there's others, and this is from, I believe it's Abe Del Rio in Minnesota, and there's others from Ohio, where it starts looking like, gee whiz, you know, there really is something going on here. Beyond natural deadfall, there's been, you know, twisting and pushing, okay, and maybe one more. And another collaborator I back in Ontario, he's on the internet under the name of Timber Giant. And anyway, but the point is, he's been finding this in a hardwood forest back in Ontario, not so far from where I grew up. And then we have this problem. Okay, if it was done rather than just happening by deadfall, was it done by a Sasquatch, or could it have been humans in the area? And so this is difficult. Okay, now, but we move on, and we have these longitudinally twisted saplings. This one, Jeff Feldman collected this and photographed this in his lab. This seems pretty interesting. The next one. Henner Fehrenbach, who you actually need to recognize too, because Henner did so much good work in the past and continues to offer help and comment. He showed us this one here, and it was one of these twisted saplings, and he found this area. It was a pine, and the blisters were quite compressed, and it actually continued a little bit over here. And his feeling was that this demonstrated that something had gripped this and twisted it, and I think he may be right. And Paul Graves, these shelters kind of interest me, because there's now been a few of them described. Paul found this one, got some photographs of it. Took me there December 2012, had a good look at it. Found it, you know, pretty interesting. And one of the interesting things about it, shown on the next slide, that Paul said, you know, these branches, whatever made this shelter, there was no cutting of branches or chopping of branches. The branches were basically twisted off like that. No, next slide. And here, this kind of twisting has been seen in the study area in the lower mainland where I started looking recently. It's kind of interesting because it says, it's almost, if what Paul has photographed and documented for us is in fact a shelter built by a Sasquatch, could this be Sasquatch activity, twisting off a sapling, thinking about building a shelter or something like that? And, you know, I raised this in a spirit of inquiry. And the problem, again, with my scientific colleagues in raising this is that they haven't got to the point of even examining the track cats and the eyewitness drawings. And they're so far away from addressing the Sasquatch that they're not ready to talk about sign yet. And here's another one directed to me by a Seattle or Washington investigator. And it doesn't look like much. But in fact, it's built on top of a leaning branch. And this was him and his girlfriend when they first found it. You can see the bark slabs on the top. And then I got there and climbed under it. And what I tried to do in this next drawing is actually describe how it was put together. It was crude, but definitely fabricated. A very dense layer of matted twigs, and then this layer of bark slabs. And I think it was a pretty effective shelter. Now, obviously beyond a bear, but could you next week? Paul agreed to take me there, which is a wonderful experience. I'm very not tying. It's been described only once, I think, for apes in the wild, but certainly apes can be trained, and orangutans especially seem very good at the very good movements of the hand. Now, well, a little final section here, quite short. I'd like to mention the tipping point, which is when a little input is enough to have a great effect, and the chilling effect, which we're all quite familiar with, it affirms the need for conviction and perseverance, because we all experience the chilling effect when we try to talk about our research and our subject area. So I made some drawings, and I think most people think, no, the tipping point has not yet been reached, the evidence is considered insufficient, even though we have, the Aboriginal myths and legends, which are kind of interesting, the historical accounts, some of which are fairly detailed, eyewitness descriptions and drawings, really good track cast, and of course, the Patterson-Gimlin film. Something else seems to be needed. I mean, if you go back one slide. One next slide. Okay, some of us think we may be actually at the tipping point. That same evidence has brought us to the tipping point. Okay, next slide. And the question is, what is it going to take to put us over the tipping point? Certainly, a type specimen would do it. That's the main demand from scientists. When there's a type specimen, game over. We now start going back and looking at some of this earlier stuff. Maybe DNA will do it. And one more slide. Then there are some of us who said, no, we just need Bob Gimlin to get back on his horse and get another pound. just kidding, Bob. Anyway, that was a great contribution, and if it were duplicated, I think it might put us over. Thank you very much.
Questions? Yes, Betty?
In the shelters, have you ever seen evidence of footprints leading into or away from the shelters, or have they just been abandoned?
Yeah, in most cases, it wasn't great track register.